This past weekend, Mary Alice and I, along with our son Logan, had the opportunity to go to Indiana to visit with our family up there to celebrate my father-in-law Charlie's 90th birthday. It was a fantastic time together. We just enjoy being with our family, especially being in Indiana in that time of the year. Beautiful Sunday afternoon at a lake house where our family gathered together outdoors under the trees. It was a beautiful day celebrating Charlie's 90th birthday. So again, I just want to say, Charlie, happy birthday. And thank you for the gift of God you are in my life and the legacy and life you have lived and are leaving for your family. And just a love for the Lord, a love for life, a love for working hard and staying in church is what you reminded us of, and that having a faith in God. And it's we had about 50 people gather together, and it was a beautiful time together. So we thank the Lord for that. On the way back, we flew up and we were able to fly back this past weekend. On the way back, we had a longer layover in Charlotte, and so we were at the airport, and I went over to get a cup of coffee, and as I did, I kind of perused around a convenience store that was inside the airport, and I was looking over the magazine rack, and I saw a magazine that many of you are familiar with. Chip and Joanna Gaines have a magazine called Magnolia, and I thought Mary Alice would enjoy that. I picked it up and took that to Mary Alice and gave it to her. As I was looking through it before I purchased it, I saw in the back a little article by Chip, and he talked about disruption in our life, and especially right now with what we're going through in our world and in our nation, the disruption. When disruptors, he referred to them as disruptors, and when something disrupts our life, it disrupts the rhythm of our life, the rhythms of our life, if you will. The way that we kind of go about our day, the routines, the thing that we kind of lean into in the patterns of life. And when something disrupts that, we can have, oftentimes we can fill those rhythms with other things and other ways of thoughts and other ways of believing or trusting. And I believe many times for you and I as Christians, we have disruptions in our lives, and it brings us to a place of either trusting fully in God or getting to a place of distrust and anxiety and fear. And I don't know that that's God's purpose for us. That's not His will for us. And so when disruptions happen, Chip said, you know, we need to fill those places of rhythm that is not consistent any longer with good rhythms, rhythms of love and rhythms of peace and joy. And the only way we can do that, guys, is through our relationship with Jesus Christ. We've been talking the last few weeks in the book of Psalms 23. It's one of my favorites, and I'm sure it is with you as well, of how God leads us as a shepherd. And I want to bring us to a portion of Scripture today in verse 5. It's very an interesting portion when you read this as a whole. And the psalmist is writing this psalm metaphorically as God is looking at God as a shepherd, as tending his sheep and watching over his sheep. And I want to read the first part of that. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing." I love that first part. It says, "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley, the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." And then verse 5, there's a shift that happens in the psalmist. He's metaphorically talking about a sheep, a shepherd and the sheep. And then he switches gears and talks about a great host for a grand banquet, and how he's generous and how he's caring and how he's watching over his guests, the invited guest for this grand feast. And it's more of a shepherd, it's more of a host and guest. And he switches gears in verse 5, and he says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows." So we have this picture of this grand banquet, and there's a table set before us, and we are sitting at this table where we are invited by this guest who is very generous, very caring, and there we have this generous feast in front of us. And it says that he anoints my head with oil, my cup overflows. I want to open that up a little bit. You know, I know many of us, every one of us watching today, we all have had disruptions in our lives, especially recently. And the patterns and rhythms of our lives have been disrupted. And so we find ourselves in a place of curiosity. It can be anxious. It can be fearful. It can be very stressful and worrisome. Especially, I know people that have been laid off from their jobs, or they've had gaps in their income, and it's very difficult. Just economically in our country today, there's challenges. They say that there's an all-time high rate of divorces and marriages because of the stress level. There's also other things that are just the tangents, or as far as the extremes. We're seeing extremes in many areas of life, where stress is taking its toll, and because our rhythms were disrupted. And these disruptors. I want us today to think about disruptors as something not necessarily that we don't welcome, but something that we embrace. It's important that we see how we can embrace these disruptions in our lives. I recall several years ago, Mary Alice and I had barely married and had our first child. We were about 2 years into our marriage, and we've been a part of a wonderful season of our lives, a part of a great ministry, a large platform of ministry opportunities for us, and we had met at this ministry. It was a worldwide ministry. We had met there and got married and had our first child, Megan. And so we were loving that opportunity, loving life. There was a rhythm of life, and, you know, things were going well, things were flowing. And something happened in the leadership level of this ministry that brought it to a halt. And so for about 2 years after this happened with leadership, there was a remnant of people that were still making a go of this ministry. Eventually it dwindled, and we had no, the support was no longer there to keep all the entities of the ministry, the different departments and the different components of the ministry. And so about Megan was a year old on her birthday. We had a disruption in our lives. We were called into an office, and all the music, we were part of the music team, a music family in that ministry. And the whole music department was called into an office, and they told us that morning that they were sorry to say that there was no longer funding available, that where they could not support the music team, the music department of this ministry, and they had to let all of us go. You talk about a disruption. Here I have a young family. All of a sudden I have a young baby. This has been a way of life for about 8 years, and we've been a part of this, and it was a disruption in our lives. That was a long time ago. My wife and I just celebrated 34 years of marriage, so this is another chapter I'm looking back at, and I could recall many disruptions in life since then, but that's one that just come to mind for us today, because I want to bring something to light. So out of that, we weren't sure what to do. I knew that I wanted to go back to college and get some more of my theological training for pastoral ministry. I felt that was something God wanted me to do in my heart. So I said, let's go to Springfield, Missouri, and I'll go to Central Bible College. And so we went out and took a tour of that, and thought that was what the Lord would have us do. Had a job lined up. And so we made the move. We took a step of faith, and talk about disruption. We left that ministry, left our friends, our home, and took our young baby Megan to Missouri from South Carolina for me to go back to Bible college. And we had a short stint there, and then the Lord led us to further ministry opportunities from there on. But I remember we were there just a few days. We didn't have much money. Thank the Lord for Charlie and Ellen, who helped us, as they have helped all their kids through the years, and helped us once again. They helped us move, helped us with support, encouragement, and prayer. And so we had a little bit of money in our pockets, but that soon dwindled. Didn't last very long. And as I was trying to catch up with my work and school, and I remember one night in particular, we had just moved into this house and getting things situated. School had it was getting ready to start the following week, but we had come to a place where we didn't have many groceries left, and not much money left. And I hadn't been paid yet on the new job I was on. So we didn't really know what to do. We had visited a church that Sunday before, and we had met some wonderful people, Praise Assembly there in Springfield, Missouri. And the pastor and the realtor of the house we were renting, that was a church that she went to. And we just found an immediate connection with these folks and loved the church. It was a Monday or Tuesday evening after that Sunday that we wondered, I left it up to my wife what supper plans were. And she basically said, we have a couple can of beans in the cupboard. And I don't know that it had ever been that bad food-wise, and but that, at that moment, it seemed, you know, things were thin, and things were, it seemed difficult, and there was definitely had been a disruption in our lives. That's what I'm getting at, disruptions and how we handle those. I'll never forget that evening before we were getting ready to, she was getting ready to prepare that meal. We had a knock at the door, and we opened the door. There was a couple ladies and a man, and they had sacks of groceries in their arms. And they said, "Hi, guys. We're from the church. We're from Praise Assembly. I know you don't know us. We met you guys, and we're the welcome wagon from the church, and we want to welcome you guys to the community." Not only did they bring in bags of groceries, but they went back to the car and brought in the ones they had in their arms. But they went to the car and brought in more groceries, and before you knew it, our cupboards were full with groceries that night. We could fix anything we wanted for supper at that point. Not only that, but they gave us an envelope that had some money that would help us along as we were making that transition. And what I learned during that time, guys, not to prolong that story, but to let you know that I learned that that God can be trustworthy, that He is Jehovah Jireh, our provider. I learned in that moment a great lesson of faith, and I've looked back over my life and I've seen times where I didn't know how it was going to work out. I didn't know how, if I put it on paper, it wasn't going to add up. But God has been that supplier. He's been the God who sees and the God who knows. I remember my mom who would just put it all out on the bed on pieces of paper, her bills, and she didn't know how she was going to pay them. And I remember her crying out to God, "Lord, how are we going to make ends meet? I give this to you. I submit this to you." And time again, I would see the disruptions in our lives being met by the God who can meet these needs. You serve a God that is all sufficient. And I want you to pay attention to the word all, A-L-L. He is all sufficient. He is all knowing. He is all powerful. And He is able to take the disruptions in our lives and embrace them with His presence. And that's what the psalmist is saying. He's saying, "You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows." You see, David had got into a place in his life that we're reminded again where he's speaking metaphorically in relation to a period of time when he was running from his enemies. David's foes mocked him and his trust in Yahweh, you know, and David was powerless to overcome them. For years he'd been crying out, "How long, O Lord, how long shall my enemy be exalted over me?" You can see that in Psalm 13. It must often have seemed that to David and to the world watching, as if the Lord had indeed forgotten him and allowed his enemies to rejoice and triumph over him. I know you feel that way sometimes. You feel it's not fair when I see the world seem to flourish and I'm having this difficult time, but yet I'm trusting in God. And there's times where you feel like God is a million miles away, but I want you to know in those moments, God could ever be closer. And God is trustworthy. I want to remind you of that today. A good friend of mine reminded me this past week that our God is infinitely trustworthy and He's intimately involved in your life. He's infinitely trustworthy. Infinitely means there's no limits to to the areas that you can trust Him in. It's limitless. He's infinitely trustworthy. Now here's a picture for David that he's painting for us of learning to trust in God as a shepherd who gives peace to his flock in the midst of danger. And you know, a few weeks ago we talked about this name of God being Jehovah Shalom and that He is a God of peace and what that could mean for us. And just to remind you, it's a story where we get that name Jehovah Shalom. Say that with me, Jehovah Shalom. He is the God of peace in my life. And during the disruptions, He can be the God of peace for you. But let me remind you where this name of God comes from. It comes from the story of Gideon in Judges chapter 6. And we shared this a few weeks ago. The Israelites had done evil in the sight of the Lord. And they had turned their backs on God. And so God had given them into the hands of the Midianites. And the Israelites, they were living in caves. The Midianites would come down and take their crops, their harvest. It's harvest time in Indiana. We saw that. It was beautiful. But I'm thinking of harvest time, and the Midianites would come down and they would raid the camps of the Israelites, and they would take their harvest. And so we had the Israelites in fear. They're living in mountains, in cliffs, and they're escaping the oppression of the Midians. And they cried out to God, and God sent a prophet who reminded them how they were to be rescued out of bondage from Egypt. And reminded them that their God can be trustworthy. And so the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, who was threshing wheat behind a wine press. He was keeping some wheat away from the Midianites. He was hiding away in this wine press. And the angel came to him, and the Lord said to Gideon, go in the strength, and listen to me, guys, go in the strength that you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? And the key for us today, I believe, that I want to remind us of is right here in Judges chapter 6, verses 13 through 16. Pardon me, my Lord, Gideon replied, but if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his wonders that our ancestors told us about when they said, did not the Lord bring us out of Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us the hand of Midian. The Lord turned to him and said, go in the strength you have, Gideon, and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? We sometimes forget who we are in Christ, don't we? We sometimes forget what God has done for us. We sometimes forget how he is taking the disruptions of our lives. Well, first of all, he disrupted our lives with his love. But see, that's what I'm talking about, embracing the disruptions of life. The one that you really need to embrace is this moment right now where the Holy Spirit is speaking to our hearts. And embrace the disruptions that he allows, that he brings, that happen in life, that things just don't seem fair at times, seems things are pulled out from under, the carpet's pulled out from under us, things that we didn't ask for, things that are difficult, things are challenging, things that hurt. These are disruptions that we can embrace a God who is trustworthy in the midst of these disruptions. We forget that we're heirs with Jesus. We forget that we're sons and daughters of a mighty God. And that he has given us the authority in the name of Jesus to declare God's presence over our lives, over this nation right now, over our communities, over our lives, over our families during these disruptions in our lives. However, too often we feel like Gideon. We feel insufficient for the task. We feel lack. And I want to remind you, the beginning of Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. I lack nothing. He's given me all. Matter of fact, this is where Gideon's asking questions. He says, pardon me, Lord, how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest of Manasseh. I have the least of my family. And the Lord answered, I will be with you. I will strike down all the Midianites, leaving none alive. And Gideon asked for a sign. Remember, he asked for a sign to the Lord. He said he prepared meat and bread and broth, and he put it on a tray, and he placed it on a rock. And the angel of the Lord touched that plate with his staff, and a fire came out of the rock and consumed the this offering that Gideon had made. And that was a sign to Gideon that God was there. And at that moment, he felt peace because he knew it was the Lord. And the Lord said to him, peace, do not be afraid. And so Gideon built an altar to the Lord that day and called it the God of peace. The God of peace. I want to declare over your life and over my life and over our situations, our disruptions right now, in the name of Jesus, the Lord is our peace. Say that with me. The Lord is my peace. He is Jehovah Shalom. Hallelujah. In this present hour, I believe God is calling us. Followers of Christ, in this present hour, listen to me, guys. He's calling us to take a stand and walk in the authority that God has given us, to remember who we are in Christ, that we're sealed in Jesus Christ. We are filled with his presence by his Holy Spirit. We have the authority to walk in the peace of God. I want you just to pray that over your life today, claim that over your life today, that God is a God that we can know to be trustworthy. He is infinitely trustworthy. He is. Psalm 34, 17 and 18 says, the righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are crushed in spirit. You feel like you've got a gut punch recently? Listen, he is close to the brokenhearted, and he saved those who are crushed in spirit. 2 Peter 1, 3, his divine power has given us everything we need. I want you to underline or highlight or bold that in your Bible in 2 Peter 1, 3. Everything we need, all that we need, I lack nothing for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. All that we need he has given to us. God is infinitely trustworthy. He's limitless. He's without limit. We can trust God with everything and every part of our lives. Aren't you thankful for that? That's a good place to say amen. And then Psalm 23, that verse 5, in the second part of that, the psalmist shifts a little bit. But again, he's giving this picture of an overabundance, of a grand host who has placed us at a feast in a table where there's our enemies are watching from the side. And we're keep in mind, our enemies are not invited guests. We are invited guests, and we have enemies that are watching this. And so we're sitting at a place of peace at a table in the midst of our enemies. And then the psalmist brings us to this place in the second part of the verse 5. It says, "You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows." The picture of learning to see God, to trust God as a great host, is very generous, caring, and loving for his invited guests who decide to attend the banqueting table. We have to decide to attend. And then he says here, "Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over." And again, we see the psalmist referring to a great banquet where there is a most generous host who has been invited, and who have been invited, and we are the guest. And here, the key to notice, I believe, in this second portion of verse 5, is that the enemies are not the guests, but on the guest list, but they are watching nearby. And then we have this picture of being ushered into this banqueting hall, into this home of this grand host, and he anoints our head with oil. And then he fills our cups to running over. It's a picture of abundance, that you can trust God with all of your needs. You can trust God with that you lack nothing. In the East, people frequently anointed their visitors into their homes and with some kind of fragrant perfume, and they gave them a cup or a glass of some choice wine where they would carefully fill it to the brim and then let it overflow as a symbol of good measure or of being a good host, if you will. So the first was designed to show their love and respect, and the latter to imply that while they remain there, they shouldn't have anything of lack, but they should have an abundance of everything. Listen, my friend, when you come into a place of relationship with Jesus Christ, it's not a place where everything's going to be perfect and there's going to be a rose garden that you walk through all the time and life is going to be beautiful. And no, we're not painting a picture like that. Matter of fact, I think the church does a great travesty to the gospel when we paint a picture like that. No, what we're saying is we can walk through this world, this sin-filled world of fallen humanity, and be faced with troubles and challenges and difficulties and pain. But in the midst of that, you can be in the presence of a great host who will fill your life with limitless power, with limitless abundance. And you can sit at your banqueting table with the Lord and have a peace in your life in the midst of a storm. That's what really the psalmist is saying here. He's saying in the midst of this pain-filled world that you know, as Christians, we have the promise of eternal life. Aren't you thankful for that? I love the Lord so much that he not only gives us abundant life for this present world, but this the eternal life that we would look forward to. First Thessalonians 4:16. It says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." So even in this present life, we can have peace with God, and we can also know that we're going to have peace with God eternally. We often assume that if God would only change my circumstance, then I would have some peace. If God, you would just only do this for me, if you would only answer this prayer in this way, then I'll have peace. My friend, I want you to learn to maybe lean away from that a little bit and just trust in a God that even if things don't go the way you're planning, even if things don't go the way you're praying, that he will work all things together for your good. So it says that in Romans 8. It tells us that my God, that relationship I have with him, that all things will work together for my good. The psalmist says, "I lack nothing." And so I need to find a place of peace with the Lord. John 14:27 says this, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give it to you as the world gives it. So do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." God may not change the circumstance, but he will give you peace. And that's what I want to pray for you today. All right, let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you today and that for the reminder that in the disruptions of our lives, you can be that peace, that steadfastness, that consistency that we need. Lord, for the disruptions in my life, I speak to them right now, and I embrace you, Lord. I embrace your presence in the midst of my disruptions. I pray and ask, God, that you would fill my disruptions with your presence, with knowing the knowledge and the wisdom and the, Lord, and just the knowing of your presence in my life, to know that you're with me, to be reminded that you are a trustworthy God. Lord, I thank you for my friends today watching. I pray that you would remind them of your great love in this short time we've had together. I thank you, Lord, for your presence, that even after they turn this tape off, Lord, this video off, that your Holy Spirit would continue to walk with them, encourage them, strengthen them. God, give them peace that passes their understanding in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that we can rest in you. Amen and amen. Listen, also, you watching today, maybe you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. He paid a price for you at a cross that he didn't have to bear, but he chose to bear for you and I. The Lord himself gave himself for you. Our Heavenly Father, this God of peace, gave his only Son, that you would not perish but have eternal life. You can find that place of peace in God as you surrender your life today. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of all of my sins and be my Lord and my Savior. I ask this in the name of Jesus. Once you pray that prayer, find a church that preaches the gospel. Get into a Bible-believing community of faith who loves God and be nurtured in that. Listen, we love you. Jesus loves you. And we look forward to seeing you real soon. I'm going to be praying for you this week, and I look forward to seeing you soon. God bless you guys.
Done for me. Who brings- that you've done for me.